The next crash is almost certainly going to be massive, painful and, more than likely, long-lived. Debt. Massive consumer, student, and mortgage debt. Basically, the exact same things that caused the last recession are pretty much in place now. It won't be triggered by interest rates suddenly going up on adjustable rate mortgages as much as people making the decision to reduce their debt. They slow their purchasing, jobs are cut, and those people lose their purchasing power. Unemployment goes up and the people who lose their jobs cannot find new ones to pay for the overinflated houses they bought. Recession triggers massive defaults, banks go under, and there you go. Not much has changed. The banks are still playing the derivative game with your deposits. The few safeguards that were put in place have been removed. The market is set for another big fall. There are market signals that show that the fall is about to happen. There is an old story about J.P. Morgan was getting a shoeshine, and his shoeshine boy gave him a stock time. He thought if the shoeshine boy is into stocks, it was time to get out. We are exactly in this situation right now. There are many parallels between the Great Depression and today. The signs of the eve of the global economic crisis have actually been repeated in the same way for centuries for modern industrialized countries. Several significant common characteristics have emerged in the past global economic crisis in combination with different socioeconomic phenomena at that stage. There are the following main aspects. 1. The saturation of the global consumer market. 2. Excessive production capacity in major manufacturing countries. 3. Hot money transferred from the manufacturing industry continues to impact prices, and risk bubbles thus appear. 4. The emergence and intensification of multilateral trade disputes among major manufacturing countries in the world. 5. The stagnation of national income growth and the declining national savings rate of various countries, and the rise in prices and consumption stagnation in the consumer consumption data occur simultaneously. 6. The bankruptcy rate and the social unemployment rate of enterprises in the major industrial countries have risen, the purchase prices of industrial and agricultural products have continued to decline, and the major industrial countries have frequently introduced measures to reduce taxes and interest rates to stimulate economic loss. The US economy is sinking from recession to depression. Why? What has happened over the last 40 years is that our economic policies have created the greatest wealth gap in the history of the country. We have allowed the billionaire class to hoard so much wealth that their doing so actually creates and increases poverty for the rest of our citizens. The tax cuts for the rich enacted in 2017 caused an increase in the national debt of over $1.5 trillion. And that did two things. Number one, transferred more wealth from the working class to the rich. And number two, brought on the inevitable economic contraction currently being blamed on the coronavirus pandemic. And this decline in the economy was immediately answered by gifting something on the order of $5 trillion more to the wealthy and our rich corporations, which blasted the national debt right up into the stratosphere. So a series of tax cuts for the rich followed by trillions of dollars being borrowed to hand over to the rich on top of those tax cuts has created the lopsided economic distribution where a prolonged economic recession, depression is virtually a certainty. We can't of course predict the future precisely. But when you consider that economic policies enacted over the last 40 years have produced stagnation of working class wages, which has resulted in a rapid and increasing decline in the ability of the US working class to pay off the national debt, in conjunction with the unprecedented size of that debt relative to the wealth gap, the possibility must be considered that the upcoming economic collapse will actually be worse by magnitudes than the Great Depression of the 1930s. And that is a terrifying thought. Welcome back to the Nomad Economist. Please, like, share, and subscribe. Thank you. This madness is now global, so next up, global depression. A few days after the pandemic was officially announced last year on the 23rd of January 2020, I prepared a chart projecting the course of the pandemic. In my view, it still stands, with two updates, vaccines months away, has been updated to mass vaccinations months away, and wave 2, has been updated to wave 4. The end point global depression is up next. Very few are prepared for this eventuality because they put their faith in 1. Central banks pursuing an insane folly, and 2. A fragile, brittle global economy that was already teetering on the edge of destabilization before the pandemic. Here's the central bank's insane folly in a nutshell: to create new enterprises and jobs, we'll blow the world's greatest speculative bubble into an even greater speculative bubble. So in other words, we'll further enrich the top layer of the financial aristocracy who own the vast majority of the assets we're pushing to the moon, and by some inexplicable magic, adding trillions of dollars, yuan, yen and euros to the wealth of this elite will somehow launch 1,000 new thriving enterprises which will magically hire 500,000 new workers every month. Can we be honest for a split second and admit that the Tooth Fairy and Santa Claus look plausible compared to this insane proposition? Since there's a tiny window of honesty open, let's also admit that adding a booster rocket to the wealth income inequality that is undermining democracy, society and the economy is exactly what we'd choose to do if our goal was destroying America. Yet this is precisely what the entire Federal Reserve policy sets out to do: boost wealth income inequality to new extremes. So what poisoned America? The US government spends at least 16%, around $650 billion, of its total annual budget on the military, and that's not counting budget money that goes to the Department of Energy, which part of it pays for the nuclear program and research. And US Space Force that just formed, which is another money pit. The $650 billion military budget is the total military spending of the next seven countries combined. America is too busy killing innocent people overseas and stealing their resources to benefit oil and military equipment companies. There's just simply no time and no extra money to spend on building or fixing our infrastructure. The global supply chains that were optimized for globalization heaven are incredibly brittle and fragile as a result of the optimization. Optimizing for maximizing profit means getting rid of redundancies, buffers, quality control, and ramping dependence on offshore suppliers to 100%. If you set out to design a global supply system that would fail catastrophically, creating self-reinforcing shortages of essentials and key components, you would choose the system now teetering on the edge of implosion. Optimization is wonderful for boosting profits when everything is priced to perfection and functioning to perfection, but when reality intrudes, you find you've stripped out all those costly, unnecessary bits that enabled the supply chain to deal with a spot of bother. Unfortunately for the central bankers, their policy of giving trillions in free money for financiers and speculators is suffering from diminishing returns. Where $100 billion once had a significant effect on financial markets, now $1 trillion no longer has any effect at all, and so the only dose that causes the patient's eyelids to flicker briefly is $3 trillion. No, wait a minute, make that $5 trillion. Nope, not enough, make it $10 trillion. Yikes, still not enough, pump in $20 trillion. I prepared a chart that depicts how diminishing returns on inflating speculative asset bubbles leads the global financial system to a cliff from which there is no return. Though few seem to be aware of it, we're tottering on that cliff edge. The final manifestation of central bankers' insane folly is the promise that endless wealth can be yours if only you join the speculative extremes racing over the cliff. Maybe the immense herd of speculators will all magically grow wings once they're in free fall. That's no more insane than counting on speculative asset bubbles to magically create real enterprises and jobs. This madness is now global, so next up, global depression. The story of the past year hasn't changed. Blowing an even bigger speculative asset bubble is the sure cure. The latest fix to the pandemic will make it go away forever and ever, and everything that was broken before the pandemic will magically be restored by the magic of ever larger and more precarious speculative asset bubbles. This was the Nomad Economist. Please like, share, leave me a comment, subscribe. And please take some time to subscribe to my backup channels. I do upload videos there too. You'll find the links in the description box. You will also find a PayPal link if you want to make a donation. Thank you wholeheartedly to all those of you who have already donated. Stay safe and healthy, friends.